I'm working on this topic already quite long time ago. We started in several projects to evaluate the performance of, I would say, new ideas, new constructions, like solar systems, or what is the effect on a green roof on the urban climate. So this was my master's, 1992. And just the background, Berlin has a huge problem concerning rainwater. We have in half of the city the combined sewer with a problem of an overload of 30, 40, up to 50 times a year. And therefore we need a retention on a local scale in our view. We have centralized systems, but we have decentralized systems as well available currently. We started in the past with the idea of just infiltrate everything into the underground. And of course it's a much better technology than to put everything directly into the sewer systems. Because there we have the combined overload, or in a separated sewer system we have the problem that the rainwater is quite polluted, so we have all the dog shit inside of our surface waters. But I would like to ask you now, is this kind of compensation of the urbanization process? And first of all we have to ask, what is the environmental impact? Or if you seal, for example, the a surface with concrete and asphalt and new buildings. First of all, we have to ask how much of the precipitation is converted to evaporation. So how much is the evaporation? Any idea? I would like to ask you, it's 5% or 50 or 15 or 80, what you think? So who's thinking it's 5% is converted to evaporation during a year of the precipitation? So we have in Berlin about 60 centimeters, 600 millimeters. So who thinks it's 5%? One, 5%. 15%. 15%. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay. 50%. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I would say majority. Yeah, and 80%. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay, maybe 10. It's 80%. So 80% of the precipitation during a year is converted to evaporation in our catchment. Yeah, it's forest, it's agricultural site, it's a mixture of urban areas. If we would have just forest, it would be 90% in our catchment. Yeah, and we have even some parts as a catchment like the Spreewald, they evaporate more water than incoming precipitation. That means there's more water going into the Spreewald than leaving the Spreewald. Yeah? It's just important to know. So environmental impact in urban areas of urbanization is always missing evaporation, and this is causing the urban heat island effect. This is one mean square meter worldwide, and I would like to get the connection to the aspect of the energy and the climate change. One mean square meter worldwide is receiving global radiation of 4.5 kilowatt hours per day. Yeah, so this is the solar shortwave radiation. A certain amount is converted to reflection, and a certain amount is converted to thermal radiation. This is related to the surface temperatures. Most important is always the net radiation, so these are our radiation components, and it's mainly the conversion into the evaporation of water. So more than 40% from each square meter worldwide is converted into the evaporation of water, and just a small amount is converted into sensible heat. Sensible heat we call, okay, we heat up the environment, like the air or buildings, for example, and surfaces. If you now look what is going on in urban areas, and these are measurements here from Uferfabrik on top of the asphalt roof here, on top. It's this roof where you entered. Because you shift all the rainwater into sewer systems, they have no chance to evaporate. You have just a small amount of, we call it interception, yeah, during precipitation. We have to convert in the summer months the incoming radiation mainly in increased thermal radiation and increased sensible heat. And this we call the urban heat island effect. So the main cause of the urban heat island effect is not the environmental, I would say, emissions from heat. It's mainly the conversion of the incoming solar radiation. And this process is ongoing worldwide because we convert about 800 square kilometers every day from vegetation into desert. Yeah, it's an urban desert, or it's ongoing deforestation. So the deforestation rate is 450 square kilometers every day, and just 100 is reforested currently. So every day we are losing about the size of Berlin in vegetation worldwide every day. So just one example. Just Germany is, I think there's a little bit. Missing maybe below. Germany is 1 million square meters every day. So urbanization is now meanwhile increasing again, because of the argument of refugees, but it's mainly an argument of the financial problems we have. So everybody is currently investing in concrete and asphalt because he gets no, how it's called, Zinsen, interest rates on the bank. This is just to know, it's the our Berlin airport, just a view on our Berlin airport, which is still not finished. I would say it's really a pity, so we have lots of problems as well in the construction areas currently. So every day 800 square kilometers is shifted from the left side to the right side, more or less. That means we emit long wave radiation and sensible heat. And this has an effect on the water cycle as well. So the next two presenters will focus on that a little bit more because we have to define the large and the small water cycle. This is a presentation of the book Water for the Recovery of the Climate, a New Water Paradigm. Jan Pokorny is here, and Martin Kovac from Czech and Slovak Republic. And they are the authors. I think you wrote it 8 years ago, so yeah, or nearly 9 years ago, and I'm really glad that you came here. So we had a discussion already the last, I would say, 6-7 years, and we made a group worldwide, and as well Danielle and Thierry from France, they are in the same shape. Outside there's a publication available, Return Water to the Earth, to save the climate, it's called, more or less. And you, it's a quite good explanation. So most of the precipitation, incoming precipitation here on site is not coming from the Atlantic Ocean, because I explained already in the beginning, 80% is in the landscape converted into the evaporation of water, and just about 20% is runoff. That means our precipitation is not coming from the Atlantic Ocean, it's the evaporated water coming from Spain, from France, from Brandenburg, and even here inside of Berlin. It's important to know, so this is the main environmental impact currently. For example, Spain was completely forested still in the Middle Age. And because we are losing now water, if you don't evaporate 1 cubic meter of water anymore, you get less 1 cubic meter of precipitation, and as a chain reaction, if you don't get this precipitation, it's 80% in the next stage, and then it's 64%. So it's like a chain reaction in producing drought and climate change. And if you don't evaporate 1 cubic meter in our catchment about in Europe, you will get less 5 cubic meters of precipitation. Yeah. And this is causing as well this urban heat island effect and a local warming. Why I show this picture? In my view, we need to learn from the past. If you look to all these old urban areas or in these old cultures, you will just find desert. Yeah? But it was not desert. It makes no sense. It's the Egypts just founded their high culture in a desert. It was all tropical rainforest. They started with deforestation, and then after hundreds and thousands of years, they didn't receive any precipitation anymore. So you can just go, for example, to Syria, Iran, Iraq, or Uruk 5,000 years ago. There have been streams inside of the city, of these urbanization areas. It was completely forested from the Mediterranean Sea until Euphrates with Cedar. I don't know the English word for it. Cedar. Okay. And so this was all tropical rainforest. If you go now to all these places, you will just find desert. And it's a man-made problem. It's a produced desert. Whole North Africa was forested. Yeah, if you go to the Sahara, you will find lots of drawings in caves of crocodiles. Yeah, and there are no crocodiles anymore. So the biggest river was not the Amazon. During that period, it was just going through the Sahara desert. And it was not a desert. And this has an implication as well on the global climate aspect. This is quite good explanation from Greenpeace coming originally. This is the incoming radiation during 1 year, the big cube, and this is the world's energy consumption of 1 year, the small cube inside. And how much, for example, the small cube fits into our fossil resources, we still have fossil resources available. So it's mainly just to argue we need to use solar energy in the near future because we will run out of fossil resources. That's quite clear, yeah, I would say. There's nothing to say about it. I'm really a fan of renewable energy like photovoltaic systems and wind energy. But the argument, the main cause of climate change, just look what every year is converted from the incoming solar radiation into the evaporation of water. This is a big blue cube, yeah? And if you compare it to the use of fossil fuels or the world's energy consumption. If you switch on television, you're always told that we have an increased global temperature because we increase the carbon inside of the atmosphere. And this is, I would say, just an argument coming from ice core drillings, that you get a certain correlation between the global temperature and the carbon, the CO2 in the atmosphere. And it's correlating. More or less, it's not so good, but it's correlating. If you look a little bit closer at what is going on with the carbon, then the CO2 in the atmosphere, we see a continuous increase. Yeah, that's sure. We have a continuous increase in carbon in the atmosphere. But if you look closer to it, you will always find a certain annual cycle. Yeah? And this is related to winter and summer. Did anybody here in this auditorium see The Inconvenient Truth, the movie from Al Gore? Yeah. I don't receive money for my presentation, but he receives about 200,000 euros for each presentation. It's quite interesting. So he's even going here, a house call with an elevator, just to show where we might end. Yeah. And that we have a huge problem. The Simpsons made a quite good movie about it, where this elevator just was a little bit broken. And he argues, okay, this is related to the photosynthesis process, because in April, June, the trees will consume CO2 and convert it into oxygen. And in October, like now, they lose the leaves, and then we get a certain increase. So the mistake now he's doing is that this is related to the photosynthesis process and the increase is related to carbon emissions. And this is just, I would say, a kind of wrong linear thinking. We are in a dynamic process. The increase is as well related to the photosynthesis process because we reduce the photosynthesis process every day by 800 square kilometers. And maybe we have, first of all, to ask how much CO2 we have in the atmosphere, 0.04%. Yeah? And in ecology, we have a cycle, it's oxygen. Yeah? I always try to explain it that in a dynamic way that we have a certain pump. between of these two elements, and the pump is the photosynthesis process. So it's just a view on it, maybe a little bit simple, but to understand, because I started to study electrotechnics, we always tried to understand what is going on with a resistor and so on at university, to start to think dynamic. We have a small glass of water, and we have a large, large tank, so 0.04% to 21%. And in between, we have a large pump. It's completely oversized. So we don't have, for example, 10% of CO2 and 10% of oxygen. Then I would agree that emissions, anthropogenic emissions, would play a role. The problem is we destroy the pump. And if you destroy the pump, we will finally end at 21% of CO2 and 0% of oxygen. Yeah. So it's a dynamic process, and we are, in my view, currently in a few cases working then on the wrong paradigm. If you look to the landscapes, what is going on the landscapes, there's one example here in Morocco, Agadir 2008. This was 2,000 years ago still called the Granary of Rome. So lots of crops have been produced here for Rome. Yeah, and if you go now into these landscapes, it's really scaring. You will just find desert. We have the same problem now here in Brandenburg. After you harvested your crops on the landscape, we have really huge landscapes, so hundreds of hectares in our neighborhood here. This I made in my neighborhood where I live, a little bit outside. And 2011, after harvesting, of course, you have to convert all the incoming radiation into heat, and you don't evaporate water anymore. And quite interesting is then if you compare now the precipitation patterns in Germany, east and west, yeah, what you find, because in east all these places have been put together, you will find much, much less precipitation than in the western part. Yeah, because it's really the small water cycle is quite well influenced directly by agricultural land use. So I would say I'm coming to the conclusions. Yeah, I just want to give you a short view on this aspect of the new water paradigm. It's we have carried out lots of projects like here Potsdamer Platz. This went into operation about 18 years ago. This was the Potsdamer Platz in the beginning. It was completely destroyed during the Second World War and demolished. This is Potsdamer Platz now, how it looks, and we implemented a huge retention lake as one of the, I would say, ideas to convert all the precipitation coming on site into evaporation of water. So we have no infiltration going on here because this lake even is a large green roof. So you have the B96 passing underneath and lots of parking places on three floors, just certain views and on it on the green roofs. And I think Optik Grün was as well. I think you delivered some of the substrates, I'm not so sure, or some of the material there. It's quite, in my view, a successful project working on this paradigm. You will get all the presentations later, so you don't need to, I would say, make a photocopy here or take a picture. We can send it to you if you give us your email address or in inscription. So, two publications, Water for the Recovery of the Climate, the New Water Paradigm, is a good example for these implementations of the new paradigm, and a little bit later we will get new insight as well on some projects from Dreiseitel and from Office Sika as well. And okay, some Kuras projects. I think if you're interested, tomorrow will be our final presentation. I just go through. So it's a green roof here on top of Uferfabrik, as well as already converting two-thirds of the incoming net radiation into the evaporation of water. And the temperature is reduced, therefore the durability of this roof is much higher. And this you saw already, that's why it's quite good implementation on site. We have a good stormwater retention value of these green roofs, so we reduce about 80 to 90% during stormwater events the runoff intensity to avoid a combined sewer overload. And we have a time shift, so the runoff from a green roof here on top, this is a green roof here on top, and the non-green roof, we have a time shift, so the combined sewer overload is already over when the runoff is starting from the green roof. Quite a good example. Yeah, and this is the rainwater harvesting tank. We harvest as well the concentration of the nutrients, because we have a so-called external overload. This we can show you when we guide you around a little bit later in the break. So I would say I can stop here. Institute of Physics, quite interesting building as well. There we harvest about the 2,500 cubic meters to irrigate climbing plants at about 450, just growing in front of the building and in courtyards, and we use the rainwater and air conditioners. So I would say maybe for an introduction that's already enough.